Just so you know, I've decided to do something a little bit different for this video. Since this topic is something that's better explored with a medium that isn't video games, I figured I'd refrain from lazy, leafy-style gameplay in the background that has nothing to do with anything, and instead try something I've never done before, a speed paint. Hopefully it works out well. There are relatively few things in my life that I can really point to as transformative for me. Sure, I really enjoy things like Mega Man X or Sonic 3 and Knuckles. Yes, I still adore shows like Rugrats, and my favorite movie will likely always be The Sunset Limited. I genuinely have a lot of adoration and respect for these experiences, but there's still a step above that for me, which is reserved for things that mark a fundamental shift in who I am as a person. These experiences have shaped part of my very core, and when I say I love them, it means something completely different. These experiences come from all manner of mediums. In music, this short list consists of things like all of Camelot's albums from the years with Roy Kahn, City and Color albums like Bring Me Your Love, or Killswitch Engage's 2009 self-titled album. Books would be Harry Potter easily, and these days reluctantly. Shows would be Boy Meets World and Top Gear. Final Fantasy VII, GTA San Andreas, We Love Katamari, and Dark Souls are a few examples of games that didn't leave me the same after I'd found them. One of the most transformative experiences, though, was actually the first time I'd watched the anime Azumanga Daioh. Azu, for the uninitiated, is widely considered the progenitor of modern slice-of-life manga slash anime. The manga started in 1999, ending in 2002, just a few months before the 26-episode anime adaptation finished. It's a comedy slice-of-life series about a group of high school girls and their non-adventures throughout the last few years of their standard education. The manga itself is a four-koma, or four-panel comic, structured in a way that's not too dissimilar to newspaper comics. Each panel is the same size. The first sets up the scene. The second expands on it, setting up a punchline of sorts. The third panel is either the reaction to the first two panels, or a breather used to pace the joke. And then the final panel is the payoff. The anime rather organically integrates this format into its writing and pacing. Jokes in Azumanga Daioh, the animation, are very, very pacing-centric. Some are extremely slow, and others are lightning fast. There's a wide breadth, but they're always very intentionally structured to mirror the feeling one might get from the pages being adapted. The show also originally aired in 5-minute chunks throughout the week on Japanese television, before being re-aired as a full episode at the end of the week. On the surface, this makes Azumanga sound more like a Looney Tunes cartoon than a slice of life, where the focus is on gags, puns, and maybe even slapstick. And while these elements exist in Azu, the emphasis is actually on something entirely different and much more value-rich. It's not moe trash like pretentious anime viewers might label it. It doesn't focus solely on cuteness for the sake of selling merchandise like a J-pop idol. You see, Azumanga is often endearingly called the Seinfeld of anime, because both are commonly cited as shows about nothing. Neither show is particularly interested in overarching narratives or drama. Characters and things in their lives can change over time, but the goal isn't to drive a story from a beginning to an end. Nor is the goal to have some definitive moral at the end of every episode like many other sitcoms that might be compared to Seinfeld, or Western cartoons. And yet, it's not purely devoid of the movement of time either, like a show like SpongeBob generally is. These shows move forward as they go on, but they're primarily about mundane events that might often get glossed over in other works, and about the characters that partake in them. This type of narrative design affords a very specific focus, which can often get tossed to the side or bogged down in more traditional storytelling, where narrative events can regularly take priority as a way to move the plot forward. In contrast, something like Azumanga has the simple movement of time pull the characters along with. The events they partake in are not a prerequisite to the movement of time, because time moves along whether they like it or not. So that means if nothing of traditional narrative value happens, well, then the value has to be extracted from the mundane. This may sound ludicrous to anyone who highly values a strong narrative arc, and lives rigidly behind the storytelling rule that says, if nothing important is happening, why are you not skipping to the next important event? To many people, you're always supposed to be showing us the most interesting part of a character's life, or the most interesting thing that's happening in the world. Otherwise, what's the point? And in traditional narratives, this is usually the best option. But there's also something to be said for finding value in the small, uneventful things, just like you would when playing a game with few preset goals, like Minecraft, or free roaming in a GTA title. This also kind of goes back to my old video on Red Dead Redemption 2 and why it's okay that it's boring. My favorite sci-fi show is one that's often maligned by hardcore sci-fi enthusiasts, Stargate Universe. This show is about a set of people from various walks of life who end up stranded on a derelict ship out in the middle of space. And when I say the show is about them, I mean the show is all about them. It's not particularly interested in exploring tons of alien worlds, alien politics, futuristic wars, and all the usual things sci-fi explores. Which isn't to say those things are inherently worse, or that they're entirely removed from SGU. But what's special about Stargate Universe is that it's very intimate and focused on themes and characters, more similar to something like Star Trek than anything else. You get to know the crew and the ship extraordinarily well, and while each episode coincides with a major event in a sense, they're often things as small as needing to turn on oxygen or finding food. In the Harry Potter books, my favorite parts have always been the sections about the life of students at Hogwarts and the magical world itself. This is why something like Order of the Phoenix is actually my favorite book. Classes, conversations, exams, sitting on the grounds on a crisp spring day, or eating sweets and doing homework in the common room. These may technically be mundane events, but not only do they fill out the world better than any forced narrative exposition ever could, they also speak to what most of us as kids growing up with Harry Potter really wanted. We didn't want to be Harry Potter. We didn't want to defeat Voldemort. We wanted to learn magic at Hogwarts. We wanted to live that mundanity. This is also the strongest aspect of Azumanga Daioh, and in fact the core of slice of life as a genre. Think back for a moment. Think of some of your fondest memories that have long since passed. Memories with friends or family doing simple things that ended up meaning a lot to you. You have nostalgia for these things because, though mundane, they were special moments unique to you and those involved. That's what Azumanga Daioh and more traditional slice of life, like K-On!, channel the strongest. They're shows about characters taking those small moments and putting them in a tiny box in their heart to be cherished as part of what makes them whole. These shows are effectively mirrors held up to our own memories, aimed at showing us to not take these moments for granted, because it's those little things that end up giving life its strongest flavors. When I watch Azumanga, I think back to the summer where a friend and I did almost nothing but play Smash Bros. Melee and Sonic Adventure 2 Battle. I think back to those times I played Final Fantasy VII and imagined creating a sequel. I think back to the days we spent exploring town, grinding any ledge we could find with our BMX bikes, or looking through endless Dan's comp catalogs and drooling over new bike parts. I think back to spending a week at my grandparents' house with my best friend, playing Burnout 3 and Dave Mira 2 late into the night. The day we got back, stopping in for school pictures and being inundated with girls that wanted to touch my hair, which had grown past my shoulders over the summer. Listening to new metal albums at the only air-conditioned house we had access to. Discussing what the Xbox 360 and PS3 would be like. I think back to our endless experiences with Guitar Hero, trying to beat Through the Fire and Flames on Expert after having bested many of the other hardest songs with the guitar behind my head, or a pillow over my face, or with my feet. Time spent drawing in every class that wasn't art class, guitar club after school, or our dumb in-jokes about every pointless thing we could find humor in. The girl I liked, and the stupid little notes I would exchange with her that no doubt made me look like a shallow dickhead and an idiot. All meaningless moments in the grand scheme of things. Nobody else cares. But I care. The power of a show like Azumanga, in spite of the narrative arc literally just being Japanese girls go through high school, is in the mundane made extraordinary. By the end, if you're invested in the characters as people, not plot devices, It almost feels like you yourself are graduating all over again, along with this new group of friends. It truly is a reflection of life, because life is rarely a compelling narrative unless you spin it into one. Life is mundanity, and our special memories are almost always mundanity given life. The first time I watched Azumanga was a little over a decade ago, right after I'd graduated from high school. I'd just found out that I was unable to go to the college I'd been accepted to, because the friends who were supposed to be going with me had backed out at the last minute, and I only got notice from them when it was too late to find affordable accommodations for one person. I felt aimless, since that school had felt like a sure thing. It felt like the path my life was supposed to take, and in an instant it was stolen away, too late to do anything about it. Who was I if I wasn't going to school for game design? In that depressive stupor, I ended up watching AMV Hell 3, which had a lot of hilarious clips in it that came from some anime I'd never heard of. It took some doing, considering it was still relatively early days for modern anime culture on the internet, but I found the name by digging through the comments long enough. Azumanga Daioh. As luck would have it, the entire dubbed version of the show had just been uploaded to YouTube in glorious 360p. Afraid it would be taken down soon, I binged the show throughout the next 3 or 4 nights, like I'd never binged anything before. I lived and breathed Azumanga for the next few days, and when it was over, and after drying my tears of delight, I went back in and watched the subbed version. Then I watched the dub again. Then I bought the original print of the manga omnibus. Then I got all but one of the DVDs, because I couldn't find the fifth one, and watched and read it at least a dozen more times over the next 6 months or so. No joke. Azumanga made me want to start really learning art. I'd always been a quote-unquote artist before then. I was basically always drawing in class and took every drawing class I could, just to spend more time drawing. I just never had the patience to learn much of value in terms of techniques, but Azumanga's style was charming and simple enough that it felt like something I could genuinely learn. So I got the rather good Idiot's Guide to Manga and started getting to work. It's been a journey full of hard work, roadblocks, and struggles, but the speed paint in this video is a testament to the inspiration Azumanga gave me, because I genuinely feel like I owe nearly all of that hard work to the passion Azumanga gave me. I never had the patience before then to learn the fundamentals of art, because nothing before then had ever made me feel that free and inspired as an artist. Similarly, I'd also always been a quote-unquote writer, to the point that I wanted to write children's books until I first played Final Fantasy VII and changed to wanting to design games. I mean, I also wanted to be a rock star, but what does that even mean? But reading published works usually deflated me just as much as they inspired, because they showed me how far I had to go. And yet, thanks to Azumanga, to this day, one of my major goals is to create my own slice of life manga that gives people the same feelings Azumanga gave me. It's something I know I can do, because it's about lived-in experience, not technical ability. To write slice of life requires earnestness. Not long after I'd finished the anime for the first time, I started experimenting with fanfiction for the series. My most comprehensive work is a continuation of the series that takes place during college for the group. It's a bit ridiculous and brings back a lot of the tropes I actually value Azumanga for leaving behind, but it was still extremely important to me that I tried to maintain the theming and emphasis on characters first, which made the series special to me. The fanfiction took 2 years to finish, and at the time of completion, it was the second or third longest Azumanga fanfiction ever written, at over 165,000 words, twice the size of your average novel, apparently. It's nearly 200,000 words if you include the prequel series I did for it, which explored one of my own characters I'd added. It was thanks to Azumanga that I figured out how to be more honest and warm toward others, to show affection and empathy that was more than just skin deep. Before then, to some extent, many relationships felt like an obligatory thing I did to survive. I valued my closest friends, I really did. But because of all the cliques in school, relationships felt like a game you had to strategize around for the sake of staying safe from the wolves. I was mischaracterized for my look and my choices in music as a dangerous, angry individual. I didn't choose my friends for their reputations, but I was certainly conscious of the benefits of those reputations. And affection sometimes came partially from a place of necessity and strategy. You showed affection because they were deserving of it, not because you wanted to, and that only compounded upon societal desires for boys to be boys and hide emotions. The culture I grew up in was a culture of clout and respect, not empathy or affection. Azumanga was genuinely so far removed from what was standard and expected for someone like me that it felt like a cultural sin to enjoy. Like it was the equivalent of sinking lower into depravity in the eyes of the people who thought I was a villain, and like I was letting people down who did care for me by loving something so feminine, emotional, and warm. Something about friendship instead of violence, heroic romance, or valiant self-sacrifice. But I adored it so much because it felt like the show was telling me that that was okay to feel that way. Whether it made me weird or not, it was an escape that didn't judge me, but instead embraced me. That was the first time I realized anime could be about much more than buff dudes fighting aliens, magical girls, or fanservice. Much more than narrative arcs and lore. Much more than fancy animation and complex scene direction. It could also just be about people being people, which is something even Western cartoons rarely dabbled in much without some gimmick or caveat to make it more traditionally marketable. The closest thing I can think of is, like, As Told by Ginger? Azumanga is an anime about an all-female cast that doesn't rely on romance or sexual fanservice, and has a strongly implied lesbian character who isn't used to excite male viewers. There's literally only one male character who's in the secondary cast and none in the primary cast. He's a lecherous teacher who shows up on occasion and primarily teaches because he's attracted to high school girls, and yet it's arguable that he's intended to put pressure on the subversion of tropes the rest of the cast uphold, and reflect slash criticize the way Kiyohiko Azuma knew certain individuals would view his characters, as pieces of meat rather than strong females that can stand on their own in their own unique ways. To me, it was powerful that, unlike a later slice of life show like K-On!, these characters weren't in an all-girls school, and yet the boys might as well have not even existed. They were not forced into a girl's world, they made it their world. The show let me know that it was okay to like a cast of all-female characters, and that it was okay to enjoy feminine things myself without first trying to turn them into something masculine. My favorite color for the longest time, even before Azumanga, has been hot pink, like I use for my channel aesthetic. I even at one point had a complete set of pink bedsheets and pillowcases, which I honestly wouldn't mind having again. But before Azumanga, I always tried to justify my love of the color as something that was badass or enlightened. Scrubs just didn't get it. It always had to be something rebellious and hardcore, or something I respected due to some heightened sense of intelligence and understanding. I liked it because girly things could be cool too if you're man enough to respect women, or because the popular kids think it's stupid, and that shows just how immature they are. It was never just something I could like because I thought it was cute. And I want to be clear. I myself was never against feminine things, nor thought that they were only for girls. I never hated on female characters or female leads just because they were women. I just couldn't accept that I liked them because they were women or feminine. Cultural pressures simply didn't allow for that. Feminine things had to be appropriated and worked into something masculine adjacent, or they were something to be embarrassed and ashamed of. One of the characters in Azumanga, simply known as Sakaki, ended up being my favorite character in the cast at the time, probably because she embodied exactly what I was feeling. She's someone who feels trapped in herself, unable to see herself as who she really wants to be, and incapable of gathering the courage to defy her reputation to become that person. These days I can't really decide my favorite between Sakaki and Chiyo-chan, but I still empathize with Sakaki the most because I remember that feeling. Meanwhile, my favorite anime character overall is undoubtedly Yui Hirasawa from K-On!, which is who this speed paint is of. She is the perfect representation of the optimistic free spirit I strive to have. She's genuine, driven when necessary, cool, I think, but also adorable and has learned to accept her fault. Her existence cannot be distilled down into Moe or something like the dumb one, because she's a lot more than that. She sees and brings out the good in everything around her, which to me is one of the most valuable traits someone can have. Nothing negative really gets to her for very long, because life moves on and every troubling moment is bound to lead to something better. She doesn't need to be a superhero or the driving force in a dramatic narrative to accomplish this. Her power comes from her ability to turn the mundane into the extraordinary for those around her, and make others feel special. She embodies the genre her story takes place in, a genre that offers great value for anyone wanting a story that reflects life's special moments more than cataloging an epic journey. In a lot of ways, K-On! Is just as strong as Azumanga when it comes to the topics being discussed here. It's thankfully yet another slice of life that doesn't feel like it needs to mask or hide the mundane to make it palatable, unlike a show like Nichijou, which is fueled by chaos and insanity. It's harder to place yourself within the group and self-reflect with a show like Nichijou, when there are little girl scientists who create little girl robots with keys in their backs that have sweets hidden inside their body, and a stuck-up farmer boy who rides a goat to school and is somehow fawned over by the girls, where meat falls from the sky and nobody bats an eye at a nuclear explosion that happens just down the street. It's hardly what I would call slice of life. A subversion of slice of life? Maybe, but it's not really part of the genre if you ask me, at least based off what I watched. K-On! Trades a bit of the comedic focus and sharp pacing of Azumanga for an extra dose of cuteness and a bit more of a narrative throughline, but it still feels very much grounded and willing to just sit in simple moments for the sake of soaking it all in. Calling K-On! An anime about nothing but girls who slack off in a music club and just drink tea and eat cake all day is not an insult. It's a compliment of the highest magnitude as far as I see it. Very few other shows could offer value from the simple act of blocking out a window pane so that it doesn't unnecessarily heat up the tank of a pet turtle, without first turning the chaos dial up to 11 to keep people interested in the shiny things on screen. But K-On! Does it, and does it well. In Azumanga, there's a section where the characters are trying to help one of their ranks get rid of hiccups that don't seem to want to go away. It has some slapstick moments and some puns, but primarily it's earnest and relatable. It's a conversation and event that I know I experienced as a kid when that would inevitably happen to one of us, and while the proposed solutions seem distinctly Japanese in Azumanga, they still speak to the reality of such an event in a very visceral way. You don't often get that from more narrative-focused works, and while narrative and more traditional storytelling certainly have their own benefits, I'm always really saddened when people see that as the only option, and act like that's the only type of story you can get value from. These sorts of shows about nothing aren't for everyone, but for me, completely subjectively, in spite of my love for the heavy, contemplative narratives of things like Final Fantasy VII, or the fantastic character growth of something like Dragon Ball Z through the Cell arc, or the twists and turns of something like the Harry Potter books, nothing quite competes with a show that reminds you why you love your friends, why they love you just the way you are, and highlights the value in memories you share, why life has value. I don't have any specific questions for you guys this time around. It's not something I think is necessary for this video. So just comment whatever you want related to the topic at hand, and genuinely, enjoy the rest of your day.